Bless you for bringing us to your presence this morning. Be lifted in Jesus' name. Thank you for everything you do for us. Lord, we can't thank you enough. We are so happy. We thank you for having you as our Father. Daddy, we are grateful. Be lifted, Lord, in Jesus' name. Lord, we are at your feet again this morning. We want to obey you. Lord, please teach us your word. In the name of Jesus. Grant us understanding in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus, the most powerful name, we pray. Amen. And the church say, Amen. We bless God this morning again for bringing us to his presence. May his name be praised forever in Jesus' name. This morning, we continue in our studies. And by the grace of God, this morning we'll be looking at how to avoid life's greatest regrets. How to avoid life's greatest regrets. A research was done and conducted for people on the sickbed who were about to die. And the question they were being asked was, what are your greatest regrets in life? You know, at the point of death, you have few choices. You're only looking at, of course, you've been told that it's this situation that you're going through for you have few days. And at that point, people look back at their life to look at how they've lived their lives. And we've been asked those questions. What are your greatest regrets in life? And there are three things that is common to all. Number one, they said, I wish I had the courage to live a life true to myself. I wish I had the courage to live a life true to myself. I want to appeal to you this morning that no matter what, please live true to yourself. It can be the greatest regret at the end of life when you look back at your life and you're like, I wish I would have lived the life I thought I was supposed to live. Please live true to yourself. It's unfortunate that so many people are living fake life. And by the time they get to the end of their life, they begin to regret. Oh no, why didn't I live my true life? They begin to regret. Oh no, why didn't I live my true life? Why did I have to live in such a way? Please don't fall into that trap. Live true life. Live true life. Live the life that you know that under God, this is the best life for me to live. We'll talk about that as we continue. Number two, I wish I didn't work so hard. I wish I didn't work so hard. If you have ever devoted your time to study the book of Ecclesiastes, he said, I looked at everything, all the labels. And after I wanted to survive, I said, vanity upon vanity. Why? When you work so hard with nothing to show for it, you tend to look back at your life and say, oh no, I've wasted my life. Why have I worked so hard? We're also talking about that because the only solution to that is to work and live by purpose. That's when you don't regret your life. So many people will get to the end of their life and look back and say, oh no, I've wasted my life working. And some people, at the expense of relationship, they chose work. They jeopardize so many relationships all because of work. Some other people, at the expense of their life, they were working. Beloved, the lifespan of work is longer, stronger, and thicker than the lifespan of any man. You met work, you will live work. So live for purpose. Live for God. If you don't want to regret at the end of your life. And number three, greatest regret in life. I wish I was brave enough to express my feelings. I wish I was brave enough to express my feelings. This is another greatest regret of men in life. Beloved, I want to tell you this morning that it is better you say that thing that you think is a solution. It is better you write that book. It is better you do that thing. Because a time will come that you look back and say, I wish I have done it. And I don't want you to have that regret at the end of your life, and that is why I'm telling you these things this morning. That you can avoid these three major greatest regrets in life if you will follow the tips of how to have victory over your regrets that I will be still sharing with you this morning. That you can live true to yourself, you can live on purpose so that you don't just waste your life on hard work. Do I say you should not work? No, I will never say that. I've always told you that one thing that God hates is laziness. He doesn't want anybody to be lazy. But he wants you to work on purpose. Not just that you were laboring and working and working and working, and you want to ask yourself, what do I get out of this? Now listen to this. Reward for work is not those cars, is not those houses, is not those luxury life you're living. No! Because at the point of death, when you discover that all of those things will be left behind, you begin like, then why am I laboring? And that was what Ecclesiastes said. He said, I have so much labor, I don't even know who will take over it. Either the person will be wise or foolish, either I will spend them well or not. So it's not just about working hard the most so that you can have more money to buy more practice. No. It's about working for fulfillment. Now my question is, the job you are doing, can you tell yourself that I'm feeling fulfilled? And how to know that is, if you were given another privilege or another opportunity to do something else, what will you be doing? As for me, if I'm given any other privilege in life to do something else, what would I be doing? I will be doing what I am doing right now, again, again, and again. Because this is where I'm finding my fulfillment. My question to you is, in what you were doing as a work, are you finding fulfillment there? If not, it's high time you rethink. So that at the point of death, if you have the privilege of looking back at your life, you will not say, oh no, I wish I have done this, I have done that.
Those things that may eventually become regrets then, please, attend to them now. And again, you don't have to live a timid life. So that at the end of the life, you will not say, oh. You know, some people, they were so afraid to make their opinions known. They kept bottling up everything. If people talk, they keep quiet because they were afraid of, I don't know what they will say. And I don't want somebody to say, it is me. And they were living a timid life. By the time they were about dying and they look at their lives, I wish I was able to express my feelings. I wish I was able to express myself better. I wish I lived a bold life. I don't want to live life of those regrets later. So it is best you adopt and look into these things. May the Lord give you wisdom in Jesus' name. Now, if you don't want to avoid having these life-related regrets, further, what are the tips to having victory over regrets? Number one this morning is watch your tongue. Watch your tongue. Watch your tongue. Psalm 141 and verse 3. Psalm 141 and verse number 3. He said, take control of what I say, O Lord, and guard my lips. Take control of what I say, O Lord, and guard my lips. Beloved, if you don't want to regret your life, please watch your tongue. Why? Words spoken in anger will forever be regretted. You say, you see some things when you are hungry, that by the time you come back to your senses, you regret them. Unfortunately, words are like egg, so fragile. Once it fell and broke, you can fix it again. Even if you say, I'm sorry, you've said it already. You can pack it. It's unpackable. You said, I withdrew my statement. But you've said it. And you may live to regret saying such words. Please, watch your tongue. This should always be your prayer. Oh Lord, please take control of what I say and guard my lips. Please let it be your prayer. If you don't want to live life of regrets, if you don't want to look back at it and say, I wish I did not say that word. Some people are where they don't want to be today because of words that they say. They say, I wish. If I had known, I would not have talked like that. So many people that they just say, for what you do to me, as you are going, you will not reach out. And they did not reach out. Then they came and arrested and said, you are the one that came. He said, no, it was just because we were fighting. It was just because I was angry. Me, I just said my own. I did not do anything. You don't do anything. They spent the rest of their life behind the jail. Why? Words. So many people, they scattered and destroyed their relationship because of words. Some people were sacked because of words. Just talk anyhow. Just say anything. I don't mind. I don't give a damn. I will say my mind. I will say my own. Yes, we didn't say you should not say your own. You should not say your mind. But watch how you say it. Watch it. Watch your tongue. If you don't want to regret your life, please watch your tongue. The psalmist said, take control of what I say. Please, before you talk, always pray and say, Lord, please, take control of what I say. Most especially when you are hungry. Most especially when you have something that is burning and you want to express it. Please always beg God. Father, please, take control of what I say. And please, Father, guard my lips. It is better you shut your mouth than to say words that you regret. Receive grace to live a life, not to regret what you say in Jesus' name. Number two, to have victory over regrets, always remember it is not over yet. Always remember, it is not over yet. Always remember, it is not over yet. Psalm 143 and verse 7 said, "Come quickly, Lord, and answer me, for my depression deepens. Don't turn away from me, or I will die." Some people took rash decisions, thinking that everything is going to end. But beloved, everything is not going to end like that. It's not going to be over for you like that. He said, "My depression deepens." Some people enter into depression, and they are getting deepened in depression because of certain situations they were going through. But you know what? It is not over yet. As long as we still have life, remember when I was telling you about what to do when nothing seems working. As long as you still have your life, something is still working. Don't let the devil tell you that nothing is working in your life. No. Something is still working. It is not over for you. It will not always be like this. It will still get better. Don't take decisions that you will later regret. Some people want to commit suicide. He said, "Please come to my head, or I will die." No, you don't have to take your life. You don't have to call it quit on life. You don't have to call it quit on your relationship. You don't have to walk out of your marriage. You don't have to call it quit because of what you are going through. Always remember, it's not over yet. Things can still be better for you. Far, far better than this. Oh no, it will not always be like this. No, remember, it was not like this before. That means it will not also always be like this forever. There is nothing called permanent in life except God. He's the only one and the only thing that is said to be permanent. Every other thing changes. Time changes, season changes, human being changes. Mention anything, it changes. They were meant to change. In fact, life is created for change. Automatically, whatever thing you are going through, it's also definitely going to change. So don't make rash decisions. Don't take decisions that you later regret because of what you are going through at the moment. No, it's not always over like that. It will not be over like that. There is still going to be a turnaround. After every night, there is going to be a day. And when the darkness becomes thicker, that time, the new dawn is closer. So don't kill yourself. Don't go into depression. Don't commit suicide. Don't take decisions that you regret. Some say, "No, I can't do it again. I'm going to quit. No, don't quit yet. Say, "No, I'm going to walk out of this marriage. Is it going to work?" No, don't quit yet. It will always be like this. It can always get better. It's not over yet. Don't quit. May the Lord give you wisdom to handle that situation in Jesus' name, so that you not take decisions that you later regret, in the name of Jesus. Number three. Always express your feelings in the most humble way. Always express your feelings in the most humble way. Jeremiah 20 verse 9. You see, sometimes expressing what you are going through could be a major solution. Oh, people used to say, a problem shared is half solved. Let me show you someone that decided to bottle up. And what happened to him? Jeremiah 20 verse 9. He said, "But if I say I never mention the Lord or speak in his name, his words burn in my bones, in my heart like a fire. It's like a fire in my bones. I am more not trying to hold it in. Some people will get to the end of their life and they will run out. Why? Because they continue to hold it in. Jeremiah, at a point, this is a minister, a preacher, a prophet, at a point, he said, no, I'm not going to talk about God again. I am tired of what I'm going through. And he wanted to hold it in. Some of us, we kept bottling up our emotions, bottling up our feelings, bottling up this, bottling up that. You know what? The best those things can do for you is to take you into depression. Just like the best we read last. But if you don't want to express, how do you do? If you don't want to offend through your tongue, then you express your feelings in the most humble way. One of your greatest regrets in life will be living without making your opinions known. Now, you don't always have to live the life of so that they will not say, I said this, so that they will not say, I said that, and you are killing yourself. Sometimes you could have the solution, but you didn't say it. Your opinions, make it known in the most humble way. Please learn to do that. Learn to talk. Learn to talk. So that at the end of the life, you will not say, I didn't mean I talked at that time. I didn't mean I said that thing. That thing could have been the solution. Now, another thing is this. Sometimes you thought what you wanted to say is the solution. It may not be. But because you did not say it, you'll not be blaming yourself that, I didn't mean I said it. Maybe that problem would have been solved. But unfortunately, it's not even the solution. But this is you killing yourself with regrets. There are some people that they will attend meetings, they won't talk. When they get home, they will not be feeling bad. And I know the right thing to say, okay. But why don't you say it? Yet, you should express it in the most humble way. So that your good deeds will not be even spoken of. You must please learn this. So, always express your feelings in the most humble way. We've seen guys that committed suicide because they want to propose a lady and they don't know how to do that. No! Express your feelings. We've seen people that they were interested in a certain thing and they don't know how to say it and they were dying of it. No! The last that could be said is a no. No, the life continues. Express your feelings. You don't have to die with that. You don't have to keep regretting. I wish. No. Just express in the most humble way. Oh, I don't know what my boss will feel about this. I don't know. Come on. The other person is living his own life. Just express. The last that could be said is a no. Or a keep quiet. And that is one thing I love Apostle Peter for. Even though our bro will say nonsense, bro will still talk. Instead of going back and feeling like, I wish I talked that time. No, he will say it's mine. Please learn how to say yours in the most humble way. Receive wisdom to do that in Jesus' name. Then number 4, if you want to have victory over regret, stop criticizing yourself. Stop criticizing yourself. Oh, let's look at Jeremiah 20, verse 7 to 13. This is a man. Look at what I was saying. Oh Lord, I'm reading the scriptures. Jeremiah 20 from verse 7. Oh Lord, you misled me. And I allowed myself to be misled. This is someone that has reached a peak in life and felt God. I should not have answered the call. I regret answering the call. I regret being a preacher. This is a man. You shouldn't live life like this. He said, oh Lord, you misled me. And I allowed myself to be misled. You were stronger than I am, and you overpowered me. Now I am mocked every day. Everyone laughs at me. I don't know, maybe you are so feeling like that. Oh no, you don't mean that. Stop criticizing. When I speak, the words burst out, violence and destruction I shout. So these messages from the Lord have made me a household joke. Verse 10. I have heard the many rumors about me. They call me the man who lives in terror. They threaten, if you say something, we will report it. Even my old friends are watching me, waiting for a fantasy. He will trap himself, they say, and then we will get our revenge on him. Praise God. Please stop criticizing yourself. Stop. Just stop it. Just stop it. Just stop it. And why should you stop criticizing yourself? It's because remember that you did the best you could with the information and perspective you had at that time. Stop criticizing yourself. Now, whatever thing you do, as at the time you did it, you did that with the best information and the perspective you have as at that time. Except if you were intentionally wicked. If whatever thing you do it willingly. And not intentionally being wicked. You have done that with the best information and the best perspective with which you can look at it. Now, life is not just with one perspective. 6 and 9 in the inverted form look alike. Now, you could look at it and say it is 6. Another person could look at it and say it is 9. Now, when you looked at it, you said it was 6. That was, according to you, the best information you have and the best perspective. As at that time. Now you may be wrong, but as at that time, as at that moment, that was the best thing you have. Then leave it at that. Don't criticize yourself. It's easy to judge yourself now that you have the benefit of hindsight or experience. Now, you could be judging yourself now because you now know better. You know what? When you know better, you do better. Please note that. Stop criticizing yourself. Because when you know better, you do better. So stop looking at what you did before and criticize yourself. That has made so many people to stop believing in themselves. I said, my decisions were never right. I have always been wrong. So there is no point. Then they live their life to people to help them to decide. Please stop that. I have told you, you don't need to allow what happened in the past to determine your present and your future. Receive wisdom to learn that in Jesus' name. The next point I want to give you this morning is, let what happened to you become your growth spot. Don't just grow older, grow wiser. Let what happened to you become your growth spot. Don't just grow older, grow wiser. Romans 8, 37 to 39. Don't just grow older, please grow wiser. Age is just a number. If you are not getting mature, Romans 8. Now don't just grow older, grow wiser. Why? He said, verse 37 to 39. Now, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us. Let what happened to you become your growth spot. Now, The last time I said, stop criticizing yourself because you took that decision based on the best information you have. If you want to learn from that, before you take any other information subsequently, you get every available information around that thing before you take your decision. Oh, you were cheated before. Maybe in a business, maybe in a relationship, or this or that. Before you go into any other world, you ensure that you get all the relevant information. And you analyze them, and you work on them before taking the next one. That means you are growing. Let it become your growth spot. The spot where you fell should not be the spot to remain. Please learn from there and move on. But unfortunately, so many of us, instead of us to move on, we continue to regret. Oh no, I have missed my life. Oh no, I have made the greatest mistake of my life. Why is my life like this? Well, I just told you, the fact that a lady, out of mistake, wrong decision, erroneously, or whatever you want to call it, got pregnant for a guy, does not mean automatically you must marry that guy. If he has not paid your bride price, it is not enough for you to continue a promiscuous life. And say because it has happened, then you must. No! Learn from that and don't make that mistake again. Unfortunately, we've seen people that had 4 children for 4 different people. Why? They refuse to learn. They refuse to learn. Whatever thing that has happened to you, let it become your growth spot. Let it become your growth spot. Grow from there. Don't just grow older, but rather grow wiser. That will help you. Receive wisdom in Jesus' name. Then the next thing I want to tell you this morning, the next point is, turn your regret in transformation. Turn your regrets to transformation. Let your regret become point of transformation for you. Instead of you regretting, let it become transformation. I said, use what happened to motivate others and to inspire others towards a better future. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Oh, I love this scripture. 2 Corinthians chapter 1 and from verse 4. He said, he comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort others when they are troubled. We will be able to give them the same comfort God has given us. Make a message out of your mystery. Turn your mysteries to messages. God is giving you comfort so that you can comfort others with what you have been through. Oh, those things are not meant to pieces and scatter your life. Oh no. Whatever that doesn't break you will only make you. Whatever that doesn't finish your life has only taught you another lesson. He said, so that we can comfort others when they are troubled, what you have been through, instead of you turning it into regret, well, let it become a lesson for others. Oh, I made mistake in this social and so aspect of life. Please don't make the same mistake. Turn it into a message. You will no longer have any reason to regret anymore because it has become a message for others to learn from. Instead of you to now sit and begin to wail in sorrow and devil is not bringing another thing to flog you. No, you don't need that. 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 He said, he comforts us in all our troubles so we can comfort others. When they are troubled, we will be able to give them the same comfort God has given us. Now, how do you want to tell someone that is bereaved The pain you felt, if you have not been bereaved before, you will know how it feels. Now, instead of living in regret, it was my mistake. Oh, it was my mistake. Had it been, I have quickly known that that is what is happening to him or her. And I have done this and this and this. The truth of the matter is, you can't do it again. It's gone. Oh, perhaps now you have a message for the bereaved. Whenever anyone is not bereaved, you cannot be able to comfort them. Instead of you regretting, why not go to the Lord and ask for comfort? Please, turn whatever thing that has happened to you into a transformation. Use it to comfort others. Use it to motivate others to a better future. Receive wisdom in that perspective also in Jesus' name. And lastly, learn from your past, but live in your present. Learn from your past, but live in your present. Learn from your past, but live in your present. Listen to this. You need three kinds of sight to survive in life. You need the hindsight. That is the sight of the past. What I'm supposed to do with that is to learn. Your past are meant for learning, for you to learn lessons. Learn with your hindsight. You also need a second sight, that is your insight. That is the sight of the present. That is the eyes with which you should live with. The eyes of the present. What is happening at the moment? What can you do with it? Then you need foresight. That is the eyes of the future. You look at your future and you believe that something great will come out of that. But you shouldn't regret your past. You should rather learn from it and move on. Romans chapter 8 and verse 1. So now, there is no condemnation, no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. I don't know, is there any area of your life where you were about praying and devil brought that certain issue and all the passion with which you want to use to pray went down? Oh, that must stop. Why? There is no condemnation for you anymore. Jesus is no longer condemning you. Rather, his end of love are open to welcome you, to receive you, to give you that abundant life, and to fulfill that which he has in mind for himself. And because you belong to him, the power of life-giving spirit has freed you from power of sin that leads to death. Those things that could have led to your regret, the power of Christ has given you freedom from them. You don't have to live in your regret. With Jesus, there is no condemnation. With Jesus, there is a new life. With Jesus, there is a new hope. With Jesus, you have an assurance. With Jesus, everything can be made new again. I want to give you this privilege of coming to the Lord again this morning. If you want to do that, perhaps you have been living your life in regret and you want to start a new life with Christ, let me give you that privilege of coming to him this morning. You can bow down your head and say after me and say, Lord Jesus, thank you for your love. Thank you for your care concerning me. Thank you for being there for me. Thank you for this new life that you have given me. Thank you for rolling away my past. Thank you for washing away my evil deeds. Thank you for dying for me. Thank you for your blood. I am grateful for that. And I'll forever be grateful. Lord, I repent of my regrets this morning. I confess them unto you. And I say, Father, please accept me in your love, in your love, in your love. I accept your love into my heart. Please be my Lord, be my Savior. Comfort me continually. Let your spirit continue to live with me. In the name of Jesus. Thank you for helping me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let me pray for you. Father, we thank you this morning. Thank you because you have the plan
for us, and you're executing that plan for us to live above our regret. Be lifted in Jesus' name. Lord, everything that will make us to regret our life in the future, we receive the wisdom to live above them now. In the name of Jesus, the grace to live above regret, grant them unto us in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' and His powerful name, we pray. Amen. Glory to God. We thank God.